Our next guest is the winner of the PhD poster contest, Jackson Seminara from Cornell University. He's in the vet school there, I understand, and you're in your first year of your PhD program. So welcome. Glad to have you here.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I grew up in New York City.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Right downtown, and now you're in agriculture.
Yeah, definitely a big change for me, but yeah. I just found out that I was really interested in production science when I was at Cornell for undergrad.
Yeah.
And it kind of changed my life, and so I decided to go into that as a career.
Ah, good for you.
So what was your undergraduate degree?
In animal science at Cornell. And I kind of bounced around through a bunch of different sort of research labs as I was going through my degree, but I ended up in the Cornell sheep program. And I know it's kind of a stretch from sheep to cows, but that really taught me that I was interested in production science. And what better production science is there than that with dairy cows? So
we would agree.
Yeah. So the title of your poster was Calcium Dynamics and Associated Patterns of Milk Constituents in Early Lactation in Multiparous Holsteins. So tell us what the thesis of your poster was.
Okay. So we were hoping to find some sort of difference in milk constituent profiles between cows that had different kinds of blood calcium dynamics. And what I mean by that is for cows at the onset of lactation, the mammary gland becomes a sink for calcium. And this causes a lot of cows to become hypocalcemic at some point during early lactation, but it doesn't happen for all cows the same way. And some cows recover very nicely, but some cows do not. And we wanted to find a way to identify these cows that do not recover because those cows are at a greater risk of negative health events.
So there were four groups of cows that you that you identified. Can you explain that?
Yeah, sure. So if you look at serum total calcium concentration at day one and day four in milk, you'll find that there are there's four different ways that a cow can sort of respond to the increased demand for calcium. And they are that the cow can remain normal calcemic for the entirety of that time. They can drop into hypocalcemia at day one, but then recover by day four. And that's the transient group. The persistent group is the third group, and they become hypocalcemic at parturition and do not recover. And then the delayed group is the group that starts out normal calcemic, but then by day four has descended into hypocalcemia. And the reason those groups are important is, like I said, those two, the persistent and delayed cows, they are at a much greater risk of negative health events. And interestingly enough, to identify the transient cows was also an important objective of our study because the transient cows produce a good bit more milk than any of the other groups. So, yeah.
Nice. So what is FTIR?
Oh, okay. So it's Fourier Transform Mid-Infrared Spectroscopic Analysis of Milk Samples.
It's a mouthful.
Yeah, it's definitely a mouthful. So basically the gist of it is that they shine a light, an infrared light through milk samples. And there's a couple of different ways that they can do it, but basically they shine a light through the milk samples and whatever comes out the other side is sort of a spectra that they can then use to predict milk constituents from that data.
So what constituents were you looking for in particular in your study?
Well, we wanted to look at lactose, protein, and fat because those are sort of our standard milk components. But we were also very interested in fatty acid profiles and other things like energy-related metabolites, such as milk beta-hydroxybutyrate. And we have actually a model for predicting blood non-esterified fatty acid from the milk. And so we were very curious to see what that looked like as well.
So what were your findings?
So what we found is that the cows with different milk constituent profiles, I mean, the cows with different calcium dynamics have different milk constituent profiles. And just more specifically, we found that our two healthy groups, the transient and normal calcemic cows, they both have higher levels of protein in their milk. But the less healthy groups have lower levels of protein, But then in terms of other things like fatty acid populations, those groups cluster a little bit differently, and that allows us to identify which cows are in which group.
So do you have any thoughts on why the milk protein levels would be different?
I'm not totally sure. I mean, I would think part of this has to be feed intake, and we didn't actually look at that. So that's got to be something that we look at going forward. But there's a couple of other theories floating around in our lab, like calcium-mediated exocytosis in the mammary gland epithelial cells. That could be related somehow. It's not entirely clear, but that's kind of where we're at with that.
Well, very interesting.
Do you happen of learnings to have any practical implications?
There's definitely some practical implications here. I mean, at the beginning level, we're hoping to develop an algorithm that uses this milk FTIR data to predict which cows are going to be healthy, which cows are not going to be healthy. And so that's something that, you know, a farmer could potentially send out to a lab and get that analysis done and find out which of their cows are going to be healthy. But in the sort of deep future, we're thinking precision dairying might involve inline milk sensing of these constituents. And in that kind of situation, these algorithms will also be very important because it will allow us to identify cows that are sick, like without going to a lab or anything. It'll all be on farm, and you won't have to touch the cows or collect a blood sample or anything like that. So it could have some value in the future as precision dairying evolves.
Yeah, good. Very interesting. Very interesting conversation. So what's the future for Jackson? I know it's just your beginning of your PhD degree, but where do you see yourself going?
I mean, for now, I've got to finish the DVM PhD. Yeah, it's gonna be a grind. It's another 6 years, so I'm just in for the long haul. But after that, I mean, I'd love to go into academia. That's okay. Kind of where I hope to see myself. But you know, industry is also an appealing option. You know, it really depends on kind of where the wind takes me.
Yeah.
But academia is probably my first choice.
Yeah. Awesome. Listen, well, thank you for joining us tonight, Jackson. It's been a pleasure.
Yeah. Thanks for having me.
All right. Thank you, sir. All right.
Cool. Thank you.
We'd love to hear your comments or ideas for topics and guests. So please reach out via email to anh.marketing@balchem.com with any suggestions, and we'll work hard to add them to the schedule. Don't forget to leave a 5-star rating on your way out. You can request your Real Science Exchange t-shirt in just a few easy steps. Just like or subscribe to the Real Science Exchange and send us a screenshot along with your address and t-shirt size to anh.marketing@balchem.com. Balchem's Real Science Lecture Series of webinars continues with ruminant-focused topics on the first Tuesday of every month, monogastric-focused topics on the second Tuesday of each month, and quarterly topics for the companion animal segment. Visit balchem.com/realscience to see the latest schedule and to register for upcoming webinars.